you with preparing for the test. So I cannot stress enough, do the quiz. We will also go in and see who's attempted it and who's not for credit. After that, we will then go into a Kahoot on cells. If we don't get the Kahoot on cells, we don't. C'est la vie. I will say, if you go and done this cells quiz on eCard already, don't come to me and go, what can I do next? I worked ahead. My problem is not occupying your time. You are a go-getter, that's fine. You need to figure it out for yourself. It's driving me nuts in all my classes. I'm not going to tell you what to do next. Figure that out. But if
can
you
I add
don't...
something?
Yes.
Can I add something? Okay. I just wanted to add to that, that if you are one of the students that didn't do the three ed puzzles that's due on Thursday, that a good way to spend your time if you finish with the eCart practice quiz on cells. The next thing would be to do that. Although I will say that a lot of you in here, you guys are so great. You guys, almost all of you, completed those three ed puzzles. Characteristics of life, viruses, and cells. There were three of them. Most of you have done them. Some of you have like done one and not the other two or didn't do them. If you're one of those people, this a good time to go and do those. They're not late. All you have to do is go and do them. You don't have to get every question right. You just have to get most of them right. Okay, so I just wanted to add that, that if you're looking for something to do, that's something to do. The other thing is, honestly, I haven't checked who's turned in the algae lab yet or not. I have not checked that. But if you are still, if you still haven't submitted that algae lab, that's a big, big grade. That one is being checked for accuracy very closely. So if you're still needing to work on that, that would be another thing to spend your time doing today. Okay, Mr. Bouchard, sorry to interrupt.
Oh, no. All right, I will stop sharing this. I will start sharing.
He's about to give it to you, Luke. It's about to come up on the screen right now. There you go. All set. Okay, so again, make sure that you realize that next this Thursday, right, the next time we meet, we have a big unit test in here. Yes, everybody's aware of that, right? So what should you have with you next class to help you with that unit test? Can you tell me what you're going to have? Yes, definitely, okay? I would recommend that you have notes either out in front of you or on a screen that you can go to quickly. Now, you guys should already have worked on those notes in class. We gave you that Google sheet where you were supposed to write down the different things that you got off of that pear deck we shared with you, right? So that's definitely valuable. You can use that. You should use any notes that have to do with cells, that have to do with viruses, because I'm going to ask about viruses and those things. I just want to make sure that you prepare yourself so that when you're taking that test on Thursday, you know, you're allowed to have that help, so use it. Okay? Okay.
All right, where are we at? 14, I'm waiting on six of you. Six of my little lovely guppies. Five guppies left. Five guppies. Oh. Five, still five. Guppies. Oh. Four guppies. Oh. I have four guppies left. Oh, somebody left our class. Or somebody not here today. Oh, we might have an absentee today. Oh, two guppies left. Oh. Two guppies, two of them. Not this many, two. Two guppies, waiting on two guppies. Come little guppies, one guppy left. Oh.
Speaking of guppies, I should do my critter cam in a little while, right? Don't let me forget that.
Oh, all the guppies are here. I may begin. Bubble guppies.
Okay. Ladies and gentlemen, we're going to talk about microscopes today. We're not going to go and wait and blah, 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 blah really long because we'll get to the meat and potatoes. Some parts I don't really want to talk about as much as other parts. We would be doing this in person. It'd be cool because we'd be using the microscopes and it'd be fun and interactive, but we get what we get, and this is what we get. Miss Murdoch redid all of this last night because Miss Murdoch's a perfectionist and she makes it so much better. And it's not bad. It's actually really good. She does a great job. So I'm never opposed when she redoes something. So microscopes, guys, just really quick. Microscopes might be the most influential, if not the most, one of the most influential inventions ever made for science. The microscopes have helped our understanding of science tremendously. It helped us develop the cell theory. It's helped us understand chemistry. It's helped us understand physics. Every branch of science has benefited from the invention of the microscope. And as that microscope has refined and gotten better, so has our understanding of science, especially biology and all other branches, have benefited from even better microscopes. So as they become more powerful, we're able to have a better understanding of life and everything. So microscopes, by far, I feel, are the most influential invention in all of science. Just really quick, we're not going to carry our microscope like we carry a Gucky bag or a Lewis Button bag. We carry them with respect. I don't want you swinging them around like, look at this. I got my new microscope. Woo! Swinging it around. We're not doing that. We're not going to get into this either because we're not going to use them in here. Here's all of the portions of the microscope. The most important ones that we're going to talk about are the eyepiece, the body tube, the objective lenses, and the coarse and fine adjustment. Those are probably some of the most important, along with the diaphragm and other portions. But the big ones are the ones we're going to hit today. And this stuff will be on your test. So if you have questions, ask them. First one is the eyepiece. The eyepiece, also known as the ocular lens, has one lens in it. And what's a lens, you may ask? Well, Mr. Bouchard, what is a lens? Well, I'm glad you guys asked. A lens is just a curved piece of glass, which is used to magnify objects. And within our eyepiece right there, we have a lens. Usually it has a 10 magnification, which means it magnifies something 10 times what it normally is. All right, so just zooms in on it. Now we're using compound light microscopes, which means they have two lenses. Oh, interesting. So where our other lens is found is in the objectives. There's three of them. This is the second lens magnifying. There's the scanning, there's the low power, the high power. And you can switch between these. I believe somebody last period told me you guys called them low, medium, high in middle school. We're going to call them scanning. You always use the scan first, because what the scanning does is it sees a bigger field, and then you're able to see that bigger field and you're able to find the object. So you scan the whole thing to find it. Then you go to low, which is 10 times, and that helps you get in more to more detail. So think of it like me. If you're back, go to the BBCU if you went for a second, and you see my giant, I'm back and you see it all. But as you get in closer, you see more detail, till it's right up there, right up close, getting all of that. This is high power. This, low power. This, scanning power. So what you do for this total magnification, remember I always talked about the ocular lens always having a 10 and these other three having this. You would do 10 times each of these to figure the total magnification. So use scanning first. This has the largest field of view, the least detail of the specimen, but largest view of the field. So again, you see all of the specimen, but not as much detail. But when you switch to low and high power, you see more detail of the specimen, but less field of view. So again, remember, scanning, you see all. High power, you're coming in. You're seeing it right up there. Hello. My nose, my eye. You probably see the freckles. Or maybe it's acne, I don't know. One of the two. All right, so then let's go on to here. Lucas, you need to log in to joinpd.com in order to get credit for today and use the code up top so we can see who accesses it. Thank you for coming to class. Welcome, bud. All right, so the objective lens is low power. Once you've found this object, you then went specimen. Sorry, not subject, specimen. Once you found the specimen, you switch to low power. You no longer move the stage. You're now just switching between the objective lenses. Switch to low power. Then after you find it under low power, you've brought it into more detail, you switch to high power. That brings it even more detail. So, high power, use it last. Again, this is what I need to stress to you guys. It has the smallest field of view, but it has the greatest detail. You see the greatest detail. You see right up, like thinking of a fly. You see more of the fly further away, but the more you zoom in, the more you can see the veining, the fly webbing, the little furry fur on the fly hair. I call them furry flies. If you ever have a furry fly, could you imagine just a big old furry fly? Little fur balls flying around. Use high power last. Okay, so here's where I want responses. You can see who responds and who doesn't. So remember, this is where we're going to start grading on if you're doing the work or not. So which of these objectives would you always use first? 10 guppies. Oh, oh, oh. 13 guppies or 14 guppies. All right, 14 of the 15 responses. Lucas, I can see you're not logged in yet. Let's get logged in. You will not receive credit if you don't log in and you don't interact with us. 16 guppies. Oh, oh, oh. So 16 of you responding, 17. 17. So two of you don't respond, no credit. That's not my problem. I graduated high school. So you use scanning objective first. Yes, always scanning. I know you think low from middle school, but no. Low is the medium. What we're, the proper terms is scanning objective is the smallest. Yes. Oh, that was Miss Murdoch, sorry. I put that in. I was like, yes, scanning is the lowest power. Scanning is the lowest power. Why haven't they changed it? Because I know it's changed in science a while ago. Those middle school teachers. Oh, I have to have a talk.
Well, don't get too upset with them. I used to do that too. I used to think, no, it's low, medium, high, right? Low, medium, high. That made the most sense to me. But I understand why they changed it. Because scanning is a better description of what that lens does. Scanning lets you scan the slide because it got a huge field of view to find whatever it is you're looking for. It doesn't magnify it very much, right? But it allows you to look for, to scan for what you're looking for. So I think it actually is a good way to describe the lenses.
Next question. Which of these objective magnifies the most but has the smallest field of view? Think about it. I got 11 guppies, 14 guppies. Lucas, you need to log in. We need to know. Bubble guppies again. 16. So, okay. Three don't want to respond. Again, not my issue. When you ask parents, I tell parents. Oh, 18. Surprise when I ask about parents. Then they say something. 18 guppies. 18. Better than no guppies. High power objective lens. Yes, high power is the one. Excellent, guys. Excellent, excellent. High power, smallest field of view, most detail. Which of these will show you the largest field of view and make it easier to find a single cell on your slide? Now, guys, we don't care if you get it right or wrong. What we care about is if you try. And these questions, there'll be questions similar to these on the test. So this is actually good practice. I like when they go, I didn't know this was going to be on the test. I didn't know you said it 5 times in class. I was playing some, I don't know, Call of Duty. I was playing Farm Fishing, whatever that game is on the Switch. You got to fish every day or take care of your Animal Crossing. I was too busy playing Animal Crossing. 13. Okay, I'm going on. 13. Scanning objective, guys. Scanning. Remember, you need to change the thought now. Scanning is the one we use. Scanning, scanning, scanning. I cannot stress that enough. All right, on to the next one. So here, guys, is where we use two lenses. We have a compound light microscope, which means it has two lenses. So the view goes through two lenses. So that means it magnifies it once through one curved piece of glass, then it magnifies it again through another piece of glass. So for total magnification, what will happen is you'll multiply the two lenses it goes through together. So say our scanning was 4, and our ocular, which I said will always be 10, unless otherwise specified, 10 times 4 would be 40 times magnification, which is what happens when we have compound, which all of our microscopes that we use are compound light microscopes. So they just magnify it more. So when we ask you total magnification, you're going to be like, total magnification? I don't know what that is. Mr. Bouchard didn't say anything. Like, wrong! I did say something. And that's what you need to know.
That was very well explained, Mr. Bouchard.
Thank you. So, if a student has a scanning lens in place, what is the total magnification? I will give you what the numbers are. Scanning will always be 4 for what we're asking right now, and our eyepiece will be 10. So, what would be the total magnification? Think about it. You have
2 lenses
and 10.
That's it. Questions. What do you do those numbers?
Nine, 11 responses. 12. 12. 15, 16, so the response is 40. Oh, I knew you were good at the math, guys. I said it. I was like, Miss Murdoch, they're good at math. She's like, I don't know what you're talking about. They're not good at math. I'm like, this is simple math, Miss Murdoch. We're going to get it. Are you sure? I'm like, yes, I'm positive. So, yes, 4 times 10 is 40. That's the level of math we're going to do in here. So if you don't like math, you can't do that. We need to have a talk. So now, if a student has low power lens in place, what is the total magnification? I will give you a hint. Low power will be 10. The objective, that will be an eyepiece, will be 10. So figure out the total magnification. Think about it. One of them is 10, the other one is 10. What are we going to do? Let's see what our Shara response is. 100! Yes! 100 magnification! Oh, oh, oh! 100, because 10 times 10.
Did you get the reference? Is the count still on Sesame Street? I don't even know. It was when I was a little girl. Is the count still?
I think the count,
The count is always, you can't get rid of the count. He is great.
Is that a Russian accent or a Ukrainian one? Or does it, I don't know. I never
The
know.
Count does not Me. Have a Ukrainian or Russian. Count is worldly.
I always love the count.
So if a student has high power lens in place, what is the total magnification? I will tell you high power, when we're asking right now, is 40. So if our high power is 40 and our objective lens is 10, what's our total? What's our total?
So Mr. Bouchard, what exactly is the lens? Like if you pulled the lens out of the microscope, whether it was your eyepiece lens or one of the objective lenses, what would it look like in your hand? What are we talking about?
Well, I guess while you were having coffee, I already said that. So actually, I want somebody in the chat to put it in, since I already said it. Let's see if anybody's listening. Somebody put it in the chat for me. I said, what is a lens? What is it, guys? Miss Murdoch was too busy having her hazelnut coffee.
No, we're not asking for magnification.
What's the description?
Yes.
What did I describe it as? The lens. What did I describe it as?
Luke's on the right track. Yeah, it's Maddie's a piece of black.
I know Maddie's going to help me. What did I say it was? Come on. Somebody was listening. It was glass, but it was something specific about that glass. What did I say? Come on. Somebody proved to me they were listening. Maybe I was just speaking to myself. That usually happens at home. When my wife wants to talk about feelings, I leave. And I go walk. It was a curved piece of glass, guys. Remember? I said curved glass. So that way, not 400 times. Well, that's the high power part. Oh, you're back to the question here. I was talking about what is a lens. A lens is a curved piece of glass that magnifies the objection. That's all right, Alex.
Good for you. You got the answer right. That's good.
Yes. 400.
Yeah. Excellent.
400. Yes. Excellent, guys. So here's the arm and the base. Again, I'm not going to get into these too much. The arm and base, it's just where you grab it, like when you're grabbing your Gucky bag or your Louis Vuitton bag. You just grab these bags, you swing it around. Look at this. Look at my Gucky microscope. Everybody knows what Gucky is. It's like a big name brand. They have a song about Gucky. Now, the body tube. The body tube is where you'll find that piece of curved glass. And the light travels through that. And then you have the nose piece, which you rotate. And that's what contains all three objectives on it. Stage and stage clips. The stage is what you adjust with the course, and the stage clips are what you use to put the slide on to keep it in place. Diaphragm. The diaphragm is what regulates the amount of light through the specimen and the light source where you get light. A lot of you guys are going to be like, why? I can't see my specimen. And I'm like, did you open a diaphragm? No. So you didn't let any light in? No. But I still can't see my specimen. And I'm like, open a diaphragm. And then you're like, okay. Oh, there it is. And yes, there's your light. So light travels through the diaphragm. And it's actually a really cool piece. And it can, and if we were in class, it'd be kind of cool to see it and mess with it a little. But c'est la vie. So which of the parts labeled allows you to adjust the amount of shining light through your specimen? Think about it on this picture. Think about it. Think about it. Answer your options. 11 guppies. Oh, 12. 12 guppies. 12. 12 guppies. 12. 12. 12. 12. 12. 12. 12. What do we got? Only 12 responses. 13 responses. 13. Show me more. More people. Live. Okay. Diaphragm is what controls the amount of light. Let me hide responses really quick. Adjust the amount of light through the diaphragm. Yes. Excellent, guys. You're so smart. I knew you were smart. I knew it. I knew it all along. So smart. So which part allows light from the specimen to travel from the stage to your eye? So how does light get from here to here? There's a portion of something that it goes through. What is it? What is it? I got 11 responses. Congratulations to 11 of you that are alive and doing cellular respiration. Body tube. That's correct. It's your body tube. Your body tube. That's where you see it. Excellent, guys. Excellent, excellent, excellent. So which of the parts below magnifies 40 times by itself? Got two responses. Eleven responses. 12, 13. 13 of you are alive. 14. Yes, thank you. It would be the high power objective lens. A winner, you're a winner. You get a microscope, you get a microscope, everybody gets a microscope. All right, course adjustment. So now let's go to our fine adjustment. Sometimes we call it the Bouchard adjustment knob and not the fine because I'm just so fine. Or we have the course adjustment, which the course adjustment is the one we always use when we use four times. When we're using the scanning objective lens, we use the course adjustment. The course adjustment's the one that was a little harder to move and a little stiffer. The fine adjustment focuses for low and high. So it's the one that moves a little freer and it's easier. It brings in the fine focus. General focus is the course objective and it moves the stage up and down. Fine is the one that gets you to more detail and you're able to be like, see all the fuzziness on the fly. Because fuzzy flies, they're an epidemic.
Both of them, right? Both of them. Focusing, making the image more clear, right? So make the image clear. Both of them focus. So Mr. Bouchard, you're the course adjustment. So is Mrs. Murdoch the fine adjustment?
Okay.
You asked for that, you know. I couldn't not say it because you started it.
Bouchard, you're the fine adjustment. I'm the fine adjustment. You're the course because you're coarse like sandpaper.
Mm-hmm. It's all right. I'm an emotional peach. I'm getting abused. Which parts labeled allow you to focus the image to make it look more clear? Ooh. Ooh. Show responses. Course adjustment knob. Yes, you are right. Apparently, it's the Bouchard adjustment knob because I'm coarse and large and bulky. I guess that's what it is. She called me large. Oh, she made a chubby joke at me. Oh, the gall.
It could be a personality trait, not a body trait, right?
Oh, so I'm coarse there, too.
Philistine.
I am. I do like the knuckle drag. It's my favorite pastime. All right, so using a microscope, guys, you always use the scanning and the low power or scanning first. You then use the adjustment once you switch it over to scanning. You then use the course adjustment. After that, you look in the eyepiece. You keep using the course adjustment while looking in the eyepiece. Once you found it and brought it into focus under scanning, you then switch to low power and use the fine adjustment to focus. Then once you brought it there, you switch to high power and again using the fine adjustment knob. So that's the order you would use to do adjusting. In summary, scanning, low, high. Now, do not move the stage in between. Center what you want to look at once, and then you're good to go and don't need to mess with that anymore. All right, so making a wet mount, you place a specimen on the slide. You then add a drop of water. Then you put a cover slip, sort of like a door on a hinge, on one side, and then you let it sort of drop. This way, air bubbles don't get trapped in. It forces air out, and it pushes it one way. Dropping in straight on top captures air bubbles. But when you do it at an angle, it has something to do with physics about it. It sort of pushes out the air and allows no air bubbles to get trapped in. And then, so here's how you do it. The cover slip at an angle. Then you drop it on, and it pushes the air out. Now it's on top. When you then add a stain to it, you add a stain to one side, and what we would usually have done is cheek swabs. It's kind of cool. Sorry, we can't do that here. And we put a stain on one side, then we put a piece of towel on the other, and due to water's capillary action, or it's adhesive, it'll sort of pull through the stain and then soak it up. You'll see it sort of traveling up the paper towel and sort of pulls the stain through. It's kind of cool. It shows the properties of water when even using it. So look at that. I've gone multi-unit notes on you. I'm so smart. I'm smart, smart like a tiger. All right. This is a micrograph of bacteria cells at 400 times magnification. Look at how many. Each one of these little guys right here is a bacteria. Look at how many we have in this.
And look how small they are. Really small. Yeah.
What other info besides size could tell you these bacteria are not human cells? Just looking at these. Chance. Take a chance on me. Take a chance.
Oh, I've forgotten about ABBA. We should do some ABBA music at some point. That's
fun. Oh, maybe a little Dancing Queen for our break song today. It's a good song.
I'm gonna find that. I'm gonna do that.
Nice. All right. So our responses should be: bacteria would have no nucleus. Bacteria have DNA, and bacteria have a cell membrane. Anything living has to have those. It does not have a nucleus. Since it doesn't have a nucleus, good. Now, notice here, guys. Oh, she's playing music. We gotta silence her. Notice here, I'm sorry. I'm gonna hide my responses. Notice the difference in size. We have these as amoeba, a single-celled organism, as eukaryote. Notice the size. How many are in this picture versus how many are in this picture? Look at that, between that one amoeba. What structure do you see in this that you see? What is the structure right there? I'll give you a hint. It's right there. What is that structure? That little dark little part right there. Put it in your responses. A nucleus! Yes! Not so well,
not an amoeba, or they wouldn't be able to squirm around like they do. No, not an amoeba.
It is a eukaryote because as a nucleus, okay?
Yeah. Nucleus is the most obvious thing that you can see from the micrograph. So good for you if you said that. Remember, too, now there's a big point that I want to make here. Remember the bacteria you saw on the last slide, how small they were? Really, really small. And single-celled. Bacteria are single-celled organisms. They're also prokaryotes. Now, if you look at the amoeba picture that I'm showing you, you should see how they're really large, but they still are single-celled organisms. These guys swim around independently, just like the bacteria do, but they are eukaryotic, okay? A lot of students get mixed up and they think all prokaryotes are single-celled and all eukaryotes are multicellular. That's not true. There are some eukaryotic organisms that are only made of one cell, and this is one of them, the amoeba. Much larger than a bacteria and has all kinds of things inside, like a nucleus and other things that you can't see here, like the ER and the Golgi bodies and mitochondria are in there, right? You can't really see them, but they're there. And those are all eukaryotic cell characteristics, even though, as you know, the amoebas are independent pond-living single-celled organisms. Okay, so I just want to make sure that you don't equate being eukaryotic with being multicellular. For the most part, that's true. Most eukaryotic organisms are made of lots of cells, but this one is not. So be careful of that.
All the single cells. All the single
cells. Okay, carry on, my wayward son.
All right, now look here. Again, all these are the same magnification, guys. Given the information, what type of cells are in this micrograph? They have chloroplasts labeled, they have cytoplasm, they have cell wall. Somebody before said it looks like a brick wall, and then I started thinking of Pink Floyd. Hey, teacher, leave those kids alone. Another Brick in the Wall, I think is the name of that song.
That's a very famous album.
It's a great album. Oh, all right, let's see what we got. Show responses. Plant cells. I knew you were smart. I said it. I was like, Miss Murdoch, they're going to be smart. She's like, I don't know. That Ariana, she's crazy. She likes some ABBA. I don't know what to say. And that Maddie Moore. Oh. And I was like, yeah, I know. They're good people.
Good job.
Luke, he does not choose force very well.
Yeah, I know, Ariana, and everybody's going to think that I speak in some kind of crazy falsetto, you know, because of this man. And I guess all we can do is just sit back and know that he likes us anyway, right? There we go.
I do. I love you all. I love you all. So this is a micrograph of some cells at 400 times. Again, these cells are taken from a multicellular organism. They do not have a cell wall. They do have nuclei. So what type of cells are in this micrograph? You're going to need that information as well. So think about it. 10 of you have seen 10.
These are not like the amoeba, right? These are not like the amoeba. They can't just freely, independently swim in pond water. That's not what we've got here. We have cells that have been taken from a multicellular organism, right? So they're not independent living cells. They have to be part of an organism to stay alive.
We don't need no pseudopods. Hey, scientist, leave our cells alone. We have multi-organelles. Hey, scientist, we are complex.
So creative.
Animal cells. So creative. Yes, animal cells are the answer.
Yeah, So here's another clue. I know we haven't taught you this yet. If you tried fungi cells, I understand. But fungi cells actually have cell walls, believe it or not. A fungus has cell walls. So careful of that. Animal cells are the only living things in all the kingdoms that really don't have cell walls. So that's something that you should know. Bacteria have cell walls, so do plants, so do fungi. So do a lot of the single-celled algae types of things and things like that. Some of them have cell walls, too. The amoebas don't, but the protista kingdom is kind of a mess, so anything goes in there. But most creatures do have cell walls. Animal cells do not, though, or we'd all be walking around like this.
That's great. Oh, that was great.
Yes, they do.
All right, so this is a micrograph of some cork cell. Cork was dead. This guy, who's the person that saw these cells and first named them in the 1600s? Think about it. Think a few minutes. You just want to think about it for a second. I'm thinking.
You are a poor influence on me, Mr. Bouchard. You really are.
Hey, ready for this, Ms. Murdoch? Four. Near.
Is that like Grover from Sesame Street?
Yeah.
Okay. I'm going to take you over to see the guppies in a few minutes here.
All right, Hook. Hook was the one, guys. Excellent. Excellent, excellent. Hook coined the word cells. Brilliant. Brilliant.
Yep.
Last
that
one.
That could be a test question, guys. These could all be test questions. I'm writing the test tonight, so just be aware.
This is a micrograph of some onion cells at 400 times magnification. Who first saw these cells, and what part of the cell theory do they show? Type your responses now.
What's going on with the cell that has these strange stringy things in them there? What is going on with that? Because it looks really different from this cell that's above it, doesn't it? That with the nucleus, it's all together. And this one looks like it's just being pulled apart, doesn't it?
These two look similar. This guy looks different from this, so this is another. Yes, Luke!
Yes, Luke. That's right. Very good. You're ahead of the game.
What's wrong with you, Luke?
Mm-hmm. Which means that you've got, yeah.
Other cells.
Yes.
Cells starting from other cells.
That's it. And yeah, good. That's good. The name of the guy is Virchow. Good for you if you said Virchow. Yes, Virchow was the one who saw dividing cells and said all cells come from other cells. Okay. Now
Lee we want to take a break. Was right? The guy that took scrapings from his teeth and saw pond water and called them animalcules or wee beasties.
Yeah, he lived around the same time as Hook did, and they were both. They both were the guys who saw cells for the first time and named them.
Okay. We are going to stop. Miss Murdoch has a song for you.
Yes, I do. Here we go. There we go. Go take a break, guys. Get away from the computer or dance or something.
Thank you. feel good today?
Yes. I feel good about
being in the classroom. That's nice, isn't it? All right, guys. I'll stop for music. I don't know where it's on repeat. Oh, my God. I don't know how to stop it. Yeah, I don't know. It's in the code.
This is how you torture people.
Oh God, she put it on twice. Yep, she put it on repeat, guys. This is how they torture people. Okay, what I want you to do right now is you need to go into Horizon and take the e-cart on cells. It's like a little quiz.
Can I share my critter cam first?
Huh?
Can I share my critter cam first?
Oh, yes. Oh, she's going critter cam.
Okay. I wanted to show you my fish tank. And at the risk of making you a bit seasick, here we go. All right. Here's my fish tank. Can you see the guppies up there? There they are. And then I got some Elodia plants there, and they had babies. So if you look right there, there's a bunch of little tiny babies that one of the females just popped out like 2 days ago. There's also a giant placostoma up against that barrel. I don't know if you can see that.
But you own a placostoma? That's priceless.
He's huge, too. And he's really like camouflage. He doesn't move around much, but he's there. And there's little tiny babies like all in there, too, that the guppies just had. Just thought you might like that. So this is my fish tank, guys. Just thought you might find that interesting. There's the snail over there. Very healthy snail. I can see one of the babies on the rocks too. So I just thought you might like that. We're going to go back to my desk. And I'm going to turn around. Okay. Yeah. All right.
Go okay, in the guys.
Yes.
So go on in. And you can do...